Hey guys, what's up? Welcome back to Asgard and welcome back to Project Ozone 2. So, since last episode, I've been doing a lot with logistics and combining our farms that we're working on last episode. So if we pop over here, and I did do a little bit of crop breeding as well, of course, and all that good stuff. Over here, let's see, this area has a farming station. This was the first one I put down. Just so that we could start getting that rose red and the cactus greens and stuff automatically because we needed that for plastic production. So I did set this one up. I also set one up in the Pam's Harvest Craft area. I actually just set this one up shortly before starting the recording. The main reason I was doing that is so that we could start getting stuffed eggplant. So, let's see. Over here, there's one. This one has all of our like sulfur, nether, glowstone, rubber, all that stuff is in here. And then also over here is one. This is mostly new crops except for that sheep crop that we had last episode. But we have pulsating iron, conductive iron, redstone alloy, solarium, mana steel, gold, electrotene, bronze, and invar. So I figured now that we have auto farms and stuff, I tried to do a lot of priority crops in this one. Because having like conductive iron, pulsating iron, stuff like that, it makes life so much easier moving forward. It really does. So I tried to prioritize those crops when I was setting up that farm. As of right now, I haven't got a farm in place for the magical crops leaves just yet, or petals. And then I also don't have one in this area where that industrial hemp is, but that's not really any kind of a rush at this point, especially until I get more crops in there. Over here is where I spent a lot of my time. This is basically telling me, reminding me that I need to continue doing recipes with Technicolor and Nature Essence. But I did spend a while working on this. This is actually two separate drawer systems. So this one here is our buffer drawers for essences. All the essences that we're currently farming go into here, and then from here they're piped into crafters. And we have, like for example, in this one we have like wool, endstone, ink, vines, dirt, raw beef, pure nether quartz, soul sand. Then over here we have sulfur, obsidian, nether quartz, nether brick, blaze rod, glowstone dust, leather, and raw rubber. Now some of these, like for example, this one we set up last episode. I just kind of moved it. But basically these are set up in different crafters just to ensure that we have kind of a nice spread of items being created and not just a bunch of the same thing, building up. And then in this one we have like gold ore, because gold is something that we actually needed a lot of. And I'm kind of letting it build up right now. And the reason being, I mean, we have about 3,000 gold, which sounds like a lot. But the thing is, these item speed upgrades for logistics pipes, I'm going to want a lot of these, honestly. A whole lot of them. And they do require 4 gold, an iron chipset, and paper for each one. Now, iron we have a lot of, redstone we have a lot of, paper, we can make a lot of that because we have quite a bit of sugarcane that's building up. But gold is, it's not the most common thing from saving, so I did try to prioritize that crop. So basically what's happening is it's producing that gold ore, and then I have a little area set up over here. Now this is just temporary. Granted, I could pump in like flint or dark steel balls or something like that to increase the output, but I'm not too concerned about that because hopefully before too long we'll get into mechanism and get into ore quintupling, which is, that's going to be huge. But right here, I just basically have an ender chest, and it's fed the gold ore. It's on the light gray, light gray, light gray channel. And then it goes into a sag mill. The sag mill outputs to the right and to the top, and on the top, I have an item filter here with just cobblestone in it, so that it sends all the cobblestone up here because I don't want that. And basically all the gold and I believe it's copper that it was producing. It was some other dust I noticed it was producing. I didn't pay it too much attention. Let me see. Yeah, pulverized copper. That stuff's just going into the alloy smelter here and then being fed into, the white inner chest, and basically that just inputs into the system. So, we are going to finish working, or we're going to get into working on this in the very near future. So, just a heads up. I've just got to get, we've got so many projects going, and it's not the top on my list right now. And then over here, there is another drawer system. This one has a drawer controller on the bottom. And it's basically, this one is actually, if you notice, it's connected up to our logistics system. And our logistics pipes, they run around. Let me actually switch over to here. The logistics pipes kind of just run through, and then they go up after crossing the room, and they're going through the bridge area. I'm going to end up facading that, you know, once we actually set up the proper bridge and everything. I'll set that up. And basically, these are for storing essences, and only essences that are used for kind of things that we would want on hand, but not auto-crafted. The major thing, like for example, if you take a look at like nether essence, for example, you know, I'm already creating soul sand, nether bricks, and nether rack. But if you take a look at the essence here, it can also be used to create enchanted books. And so that's why I'm keeping those essences connected to the system so that we can, once we get experience seeds, we can do the experience books and have those crafted in the system so we can say just order Smite 5 and it'll just make a Smite 5 book using all of the essence. So basically whenever essence comes in, it's round robined to this or to this. So you can see we've already got over 1,000 nether essence, over 1,200 obsidian essence. You know, there's a bunch of essences building up in here. And then next to it, we have all of our Pam's Harvest Craft stuff that's being produced at the moment. Garlic and eggplant were the primary things that I wanted out of this, you know, but because we're going to be using those today. And then I'm also going to have our mana petals and industrial hemp, things like that. Or actually industrial hemp, I have a place over there for it. But, you know, the petals, things that take up a lot of space that we really don't have room for in our primary system are going to come into here. And then probably over in this section, we're going to add another little added feature to this once we get to it. So basically, you know, once this is all done, this room's just going to be for sorting and sorting and extended storage. Also, I have an additional ender chest right here on the gray channel. This one, you can see it's got nether quartz in here, and oh, you know what, it's out of stone right now because I still haven't plucked up our cobblework system to this. I need to do that. But basically the gray ender chest is right here with the translocator, and this one's set to keep a stack of stone and a stack of nether quartz in it. And the reason being is because nether quartz is used to make pure nether quartz using quartz essence, and stone is used to make like endstone. You can see I've got quite a bit of endstone built up in here. And there's nether quartz, mana steel. I just wanted that stuff kind of building up so that we had it on hand. I mean, pure nether quartz, we're not using it right this second, but we're going to have plenty of nether quartz essence coming in. We have a ton of nether quartz already just from, you know, the round robin. So basically, you know, half of it goes in to make pure nether quartz, half of it goes in to make standard quartz right now. So, also our plastic is plugged up to the system. You can see I've finished these out. We have 512 of every plastic. Honestly, I mean, I ended up making a bedrockium drum here. And you can see we have almost 15 million millibuckets of liquid plastic. It builds up insanely fast. And the LPG, I've just basically got an ender tank field. You know, it's limited by the storage of the ender tank. Once we set up the fluid area, we will expand storage and have, like, probably bedrockium drums for, like, everything. Because, honestly, bedrockium drums are really cheap. It's making the actual bedrock. Because bedrockium drums, they only take 6 ingots. Which is, I mean, that's not expensive at all. 6 ingots of bedrockium. And, you know, each of these is one block of bedrockium. Bedrockium being only one octuple compressed cobblestone. But bedrock requires 9 blocks of bedrockium. So it takes a little bit longer to make bedrock than it does to make bedrockium drums. I haven't added any extra bedrock setups to the farms down here. And one thing I did forget to mention last episode, and I wanted to bring it to you guys' attention, right underneath here, there's where the bedrock's at. And, oh, I just realized, yeah, cannot grow. Okay, replace that real quick. But the bedrock's just down there, just so it's out of sight. And the dark iron bars, just so you know, you don't actually have to connect those to any kind of bedrock. You know, these grow just fine. It says this plant is fertile and can grow. They grow just fine, only having bedrock underneath that. So for each capacitor setup that you have, you just put, you know, you just need one piece of bedrock in your set. So this entire, these four farm crops, it's just 4 bedrock for that entire thing. So I know in the description it said you need to, like, connect these, like, ground them into bedrock, but no, you don't. You don't have to do that. So, anyways, that's the main things I've been working on. I mean, I've done a little bit of stuff with autocrafting and started working in this section just a little bit. Also, I did automate stuffed eggplant. And I automated all the storage upgrades because crafting those by hand was getting terrible because I was needing a lot of them. They're not expensive. They're recursive crafting kind of thing and drives me insane. So I did go ahead and automate that. But stuffed eggplant, the way I have this automated is we have, you know, eggplant, garlic, bakeware, of course, and bakeware is already in here. If you take a look at the actual recipe, it tells it if you send eggplant and garlic, you're going to get stuffed eggplant. And then I just have an item conduit here with a filter to pull out bakeware. So it pulls the bakeware out, sends it to this chest, and then sends it right back into the crafter. That's just a temporary setup. Long term, we'll do something a little bit different with the stuff because long term, you know, I'd like to automate a lot of the Pam's Harvest Craft food, if not all of it, just for the sake of doing it. So we'll handle the bakewares and the pots and stuff like that. We'll handle that a little bit differently. But for the moment, that works fairly well. So anyways, today, this video should come out on Saturday. First off, I want to say that I hope you guys have a wonderful Easter weekend. I know I've got a pretty busy weekend, but I will say that this video is coming out on Saturday. There should be another video out, hopefully, on Sunday. Because I'm going to spend a while working on here and we're going to come back and do a little bit more on Sunday. And then the following episode will be on the Wednesday, you know, so you guys will hopefully get an extra episode this week. But I hope you guys do have a wonderful Easter and everything. And today we are going to be working on Botania. We are going to spend the day, probably the entirety of the episode, working on Botania because that's the primary thing right now that's holding us back. Now, before we get into that, we do have a couple quests here that are completed. First up, the Electrotine Seeds. This quest is completed, so let's go ahead and take our reward bag. Also, if you guys recall, you know, I said before that I'd like to start working towards the Nether Star Seeds in the very near future because they're not that expensive. We need 4 Nether Stars is basically the primary cost for this. Once we get Gaia Spirits, which by the time we get to where we can make Temperial Essence, we'll have Gaia Spirits. And then we need a whole bunch of Temperial Essence. But then I got to looking, and these Nether Star Seeds require Awakened Draconium to actually grow them. So it's going to be a little while on that, honestly. Yeah, so just a heads up. Also, we have another quest here. I did go ahead and complete the Con quest for all the different kinds of conduits. So we'll go ahead and grab that reward bag as well. So we got 2 greater reward bags. We got 3 automatic hammers. I might end up using those for something. And we got a Better Furnaces electric heat source and a BFESU. Interesting. I can't say for sure that I'll use that because we've already crafted those. Had we got it a while back, that might be different. But I'm going to throw this in here. I don't know for sure if it's actually going to go anywhere, but there's enough space in here I can store some things until I finally get around to sending them somewhere. So anyways, like I said, today, Botania all day. And of course, the first thing that we're going to be going for is the Elven Portal. because that's the first thing that we're going to need to really progress with the mod. However, doing that, I'm going to want some kind of strong mana production. Something that's constant. I mean, you know, these hydrangeas, they work fine. They're really not enough mana, I don't believe, to keep an elven portal open, though. Because I remember in the past I had to do, like, a few of them. Back before Botania made these decay, I used to do a few of these to keep an elven portal up. And the XP stuff, I mean, that's not automated. And honestly, we'll probably start moving away from that. By the way, on XP, we do have quite a bit. 622. So we'll probably get into the spawn room at some point once we work through some of these more crucial projects that we're working on. So to do that, to actually, you know, get into producing mana for the Elven Portal, what we're going to use is we are going to use stuffed eggplant. Because honestly, I mean, we're harvesting a lot of that stuff. And stuffed eggplant with the Gormialis does produce a lot of mana, honestly. Pam's Harvestcraft is very effective to use with the Gormialis. And what this flower does, of course, is it eats food, basically. And it's fairly cheap to craft. We're going to need some runes of summer and runes of fire, earth, air, melon, slime, sand. Okay. None of that's too bad. I don't know. Let me see if I have those runes of earth and air made up already. Yes, we have earth and air. Wonderful. Wonderful stuff. And then in addition, we are going to need some petals. We're going to need 2 yellow, 2 light gray, and red. The only one that we don't have a lot of is light gray. So. And now we have plenty of those. Okay. So, let's see. Rune of Fire, though. I am going to have to make a few of those. That's Nether Wart, Gunpowder, Mana Powder, Nether Brick, and Mana Steel. Okay. And I think we'll go with, like, maybe 4 flowers to start with. So I am going to need, like, 3. Oh, I've got 1. So let's get Mana Powder, Mana Steel, Gunpowder, Nether Wart. Now, Nether Wart I'm actually pretty low on. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use Blaze Rods. I keep forgetting to do Nether Wart as an agricraft crop and, like, level it and stuff. So I need to try to do that between this episode and next. That's definitely one that I need to prioritize. Okay, and then Mana Steel is not a problem. We have plenty of that. I'll tell you what, one of the best things is having all those alloys on hand. So nice. It really is. But we can throw the Blaze Rods into the Alchemy Catalyst and get Nether Wart from that. And then, of course, we're going to need a little bit of Mana Powder. That's fine. And now we should be all set. Let's do... this, and let me get my Wand of the Forest. And I think we'll do like one more craft of this for right now. And that should be enough since we get 2 of those runes. Alright, so the other thing that we're going to need is those runes of summer, which require slime balls, melons, and 2 sand for each one. Sometimes I step in here. That's one thing I like about having this storage right here, because all the primary ingredients that we need, like we use a lot of, are right there on hand. Oh, by the way, I did change all of our golden transport pipes over to logistics pipes. So I don't think we have any more golden transports lying around. Because I did kind of want to clean that up because we're going to be doing speed upgrades just to really speed up our system. It is going to be something that takes a little while to do just because of that. Those speed upgrades, they're not terribly expensive, but they're not terribly cheap either. So it is going to take a little while on that. And I guess let's go ahead and order ourselves a little bit of wheat. And I know I was talking about last episode getting started on the greenhouses. And I know I haven't done that yet. Generally, if you've noticed, I tend to do Project Ozone on Sunday as like my main day. You know, I'll do an episode on Wednesdays, but then I'll do the following episode on Sunday. That way I have a little bit more time to work on the stuff because Ozone does take a while. You know, if you look up there at the day, I mean, we're already at day 634. I have had a couple, you know, passive days, but like where I'll leave it running like overnight or something like that. But even still, we have spent a ton of time on this series thus far. We needed, what, 1 red, 2 of these. There we go. Anyways, hopefully by next episode, I should have a bit of work done on those greenhouses. Is kind of my goal. Alright, and while that's finishing up, let's go ahead and get the materials that we're actually going to need. I think, what, just like 3 glowstone, and then we're going to need Terra Steel? I need to actually set up a Batania chest for like a lot of this miscellaneous Batania stuff. Order a little bit more stuffed eggplant. That way it crafts it, and whenever we come back through here, we can just keep stocked on food and stay at like a stack of food. It's wonderful. Once you have really good food like that automated, it does make life so much easier. Okay, so we've got our 4 Gormialis. Now let's get ourselves a bit of living wood here. And I can't remember where I put the... okay, here's the Terra Steel. So we'll go ahead and get, we're going to need some Terra Steel Nuggets. And then we get to make all the pieces for our Elven portal. And we'll go ahead and set that up where it's going to go. Let me just grab a bit of that as well. So we're going to need a couple mana pools. And if we take a look here at the quest, we're going to need living wood. We've got that glimmering living wood. It's just living wood and glowstone. So we'll go ahead and get 3 pieces of that. And then the Elven Gateway Core is living wood with Terra Steel. So we'll get that. And then that completes this quest. So we'll go ahead and claim the reward. Now that's not actually all that we need though, in fact. What is this? A greater bag? Okay, we got an auto enchantment table. Wonderful. What's the next quest? Elven Dreams. Okay, make a bunch of the Elven stuff. Okay. So, I guess we're going to set the gateway up. Okay, we'll go ahead and visualize this so we can kind of get an idea. One thing I hate is that these mana pools have to be on the same level as this, because I want to put it down one into the ground. But I guess we're going to put this like 2 out. Yeah, we're going to put it right there, I think. I know you'll be able to see it through the windows, but I think that would be a good spot. And then we can have the Gourmet Alice set up out here. Should work out perfectly. So we'll go ahead and just kind of set these pieces up. We are going to have to make the crystals shortly. That goes there. And then the living wood. And we'll just lay that out like that. Wonderful. Alright, so now we just need the pylons. That's what I was trying to think. Pylons. Natura pylons, they require mana pylons and Eyes of Ender, and then Terra Steel Nuggets. Okay. And I can't remember, did I teach my system to make... Nope. Alright, that's fine. So there's our 2 Eyes of Ender. Easy enough. And then we'll grab the pylons that we used to have with that one enchantment table that I was working with. We'll just grab that. Because, of course, that was just something I was trying to get stuff on those spikes and couldn't get it to work. So that'll be okay. Natura pylons, there's 2 of those. Honestly, we're reaching the point where most everything, you know, it might have a lot of crafting steps, but, like, there's not a whole lot of just really expensive stuff for us at the moment. So anyways, there we go. We have our Elven Gateway set up. And so now what I want to do is I want to set up our Gourmet Alice. And I think for decorative purposes, I think what we're going to do... I was thinking about doing red string so that we don't have... You know, we can... Basically, I was thinking about doing red string so we could have the setup back here and then red string it up. Actually, you know what I could do? Let's see, the floor is right there. Okay, what we're going to do is we're going to have a mana spreader right there. And we're going to have a mana spreader right here. Because basically I just want to hide the, you know, the redstone work and stuff like that. I want to hide it. I don't want it cluttering up our garden area. I mean, I know there's some clutter over there. That all is short-term stuff that's going to be removed. Let me double-check. I can't remember the range of this. Oh, yeah, we're not going to be able to see it in there. We're going to need a monocle, right? So we're going to get our mana seer monocle, just mana steel and mana glass. Not a problem. So there's our mana seer monocle. And we'll just throw this on right there. That's fine. So we have, like, this spiffy little monocle here. And so now if we take a look at a flower, we can see the range of it, like the effective range that it can get stuff and all that good stuff. So I'm thinking what we'll do is we'll just set up our flowers like right here. Okay, yeah, it is a very small range. So we'll have that there, and we're going to have a couple Gourmet Alice right here. And then what I'll do is the other two, we'll probably end up making 4 for each side, and we'll put the other two like right here. Maybe. We'll see. Well, really, honestly, this is going to make enough mana to keep this running. Because it really doesn't use up that much mana as long as you keep it on all the time. Now, in 1.10, of course, they changed that, so it only uses mana whenever you craft. But And 1.7, it's a constant drain. So now what we're going to need is let's get ourselves, let's see, I'm going to want a mana spreader and a couple open crates. I love the range on this wireless charger. I feel like it's very large. I don't feel like it's normally that large. I mean, it's pretty much like my entire base I can charge my jetpack from. But anyways, we're just going to get two standard mana spreaders for the time being, and then we'll probably honestly, I don't think we'll really have to upgrade, but we probably will just for looks, purposes, and stuff like that. But all right, so we're going to see. Send that to there. And we're going to send this one to there, and then we're going to bind our flowers to their mana spreader. Just like that. And then, let's see. That's pretty much the exterior. So now we're going to pop on over to the interior and do some work. Oh, like I said, I am going to need some open crates. Which I'm pretty sure that's just living wood plank. Yeah, okay. Let's get a few living wood planks and get our two open crates. And I think what we're going to do is these open crates, we're going to put them right above the mana spreader. Okay, so, or no, not right there. We're going to put them right here. So I don't think that's a whole lot of intrusion on the area. I mean, it still looks pretty good, I think. So that's what we're going to do. And then, let's see, we don't happen to have some kind of a comparator. I'm going to cook up some more of these stone plates. I will say that whenever we go and we move, you know, where the cobble works is at, that'll be slightly moved just because I want the noise to be away. Plus, I've added some expansions to the cobblestone framework stuff, just so we have a little bit more cobblestone being produced to help with creating all that bedrockium that we're going to need. So we are going to move that long term. And once we do, I'll add the stone plates to that, or circuit plates to that. But anyways, let's go ahead and make a comparator from Project Red. So we're going to need just some conductive plate. Let's see, how many of those am I going to need? Four. And then we're going to need this. Can I, okay, we do have a redstone torch. Our cathode. And then our comparator, let's go ahead and order that. Okay. So that's ordered, and let me grab just a little bit of cobblestone so we can build kind of a platform where we're going to be working today, or for right now, you know. 64 should be fine, and let's go ahead and pop down under the building here. You see, that's where I ran logistics pipes and all that good stuff. This hover does make it so much easier. It really, really does. Okay, so we're just going to run this out. Okay, so there we go. And I'm going to go ahead and actually just remove, like, a little bit of this concrete for temporary. Plus, it'll make getting down here a little bit quicker because I can just pop through the floor there. So basically, what we're going to need to do is we're going to need to set up some kind of a system to feed the open crate. And we also want it to limit the drop rate so that it's not... You know, we don't want it just dropping all the time, basically. Actually, you know what? Instead of using the comparator, now that I think about it, I don't really need that. Because I almost forgot that we have BC pipes in here. So, what we're going to do is let's get ourselves a structure pipe. We'll order one of those. And then we're also going to want a gate. Let's see. We'll just do a basic gate. Red pipe wire and redstone chipset. Okay. Now what do I need for red pipe wire? Iron, redstone, red dye. Okay. Let's see. Red, redstone, iron. Then I'm also going to need just one of those basic redstone chipsets. We'll get one of those. Okay. Then we should be all sorted now. So what we're going to do is let's throw this stuff into here. We're going to say, okay, let's say iron, redstone, rose red, and make that red pipe wire. So there's that. And then I want to throw that and get ourselves just a basic gate. Look at all the lasers. It's like Lucky Charms in here. Rainbow or tricks or whatever. Okay, so there's that. Then we'll grab our structure pipes. And I guess I don't need that. Okay, it'll go in there. And then what we're going to do is we're just going to pop down here to where the mana pool is. And I do apologize about the jetpack noise, but we're going to put the structure pipe down here, and we're going to put our basic gate like right there. And we are going to say that mana full and just redstone signal. That easy. So whenever the mana pool gets filled, it will emit a redstone signal, and that will, of course, alert us that, hey, this is filled. And we should be, oh, I sent my red alloy wire out. Mana full, redstone signal. Okay. So that is set, and then I guess we're just going to use, since we don't really have to do any vanilla redstone stuff comparators or any of that stuff, we're just going to use that red alloy wire the whole way. So let me order that, and I believe this should hit it, because this should emit a redstone signal. It should activate this red alloy wire. I'll have to double check once we get a full mana pool, but that'll be fine. And we'll just run this up. Okay, so that's where our redstone will come out at, and we'll do the same over here. Just run this stuff down. I love Project Red. I absolutely love it. It makes redstone so much more fun, right? Oh, I forgot to put one on that edge there. Okay, so our redstone signals will come out right here. Awesome. And so then what I want to do is I want to... Let's see. Now the only thing is I'm going to have to keep redstone signal away from our mana spreader. So I'll tell you what we're going to do. Let's do... What options do we have here? Okay, tell you what, let me order some more red alloy wire. I'm going to have to order more red alloy, actually. Let's order 30 of it. Oh, no, I have. Never mind. That's okay. I'm going to need this stuff anyway, because I pretty much used up all that we had. All right, so there we go. And then let me get just some redstone torches. Let's order, like, two of those. And then I'm going to want... like two hoppers, I think. And then, oh, I'm gonna want a couple timers as well. Let me, let's see. We'll just go with the Project Red integration one. We're gonna need anodes, conductive plates. All right, so we should be good now to get our two timers, right? Oh, I'm missing a cathode. Oh, okay. Whoops. So there's two of those, and now we should be good to get our timers, right? Yep. Good. And let's see. We'll finish setting this up, and then we got to figure out the timing that we want for our Gormialis. So basically, the red alloy wire is just going to run up. It's going to then connect up to this cobblestone here. And this is going to have a redstone torch on it. Actually, I guess it really doesn't have to be that far up. And there we go. So now if this side gets a signal from the mana pool over there being full, it'll shut off that redstone torch. Wonderful. And then I'm just going to run red alloy wire from this. We're going to feed it to a hopper. And the hopper's going to be just right here. And I think guess there's an easy way that we can find out. We can take stuffed eggplant. Yeah, see, it's not running right now. The hopper's not dumping its items. Hopefully the mana spreader is still working. That's the only thing I need to test. And then if we take and put the timer down, we'll say here, Is that enough to drop it? And oh, I'm derping. I apologize. The timer needs to be right here. I don't know why I put it right there. We may not even actually need the repeater. Let me pull that up. All right, so that's on 20 seconds, and I've got Living Rock in here. So it should be about to click. Okay, it isn't fast enough, in fact. Or it's too fast, I mean. I do actually want the repeater, but I want it on this side. I'm totally derping on my redstone today. I do apologize. But we're going to set... I'm just going to use Living Rock. So what we'll do is we'll set our repeater here. And we'll put our timer right here. Set that up to like 10 seconds. And I want to say that... Not fast enough. Okay, we're going to set the repeater up to... I think it just dropped one. Yes. Okay. At 2 ticks, the repeater works perfect. Wonderful. Alright. So now, let me pull that out. And we actually have to time this and see what we're going to need as far as time. So basically, however long it takes this Gormialis to process the food is how long that we're going to need to run this. And of course, it also depends on the mana spreader and stuff like that. So if I throw one of these down... Okay, it seems like it took about 45 or 40 seconds or so. So I'm going to do 45 on the timer. Or I'm going to count it as 45-ish. But of course, we're going to split this in half because we have two Gormialis. So it'll drop, you know, one, and then it'll do like a 20-something seconds and then drop another, and that other Gormialis will eat it. And then once it comes back around again, that other one will be ready to eat. So we're going to say... we'll say 22.5 seconds on the timer. And we're going to do the same thing over on this side. So give me just a second here. Let's see. All right, so we'll just run our red alloy up. We're going to put our hopper right there. And then just kind of copy this exact design. So two... So that's perfectly even and everything. So we'll have that there. That's going to, of course, shut off the hopper. And then I just need to connect this up. And then we have to add the timer and the repeater. So the timer goes right there. 22.5 seconds. And then the repeater set to 2. That's pretty much it, I think. This should work extremely well. So that's the timing. That's the redstone for it. Now we just have to actually feed this hopper. And so now we need to get into our logistics system. And we're going to be doing eggplant. And I think what we're going to do is let's say... I was going to say we do it from here, but this doesn't actually have a storage drawer system for eggplant. So what we're going to do, let's order ourselves 2 ender chests. Okay. I will use ender chests a lot for transportation. If you've seen my other series, you know I love ender chests because it's, you know, it's great for moving specific items. It's not good for like, you know, I mean, it doesn't replace item conduits completely, but it does for moving certain bulk items over. And I will say that we're going to reuse some of these ender chests. Like this one's over here are going to get reused. Like this one, for example, holds this stuff. We'll eventually add some more items that use the translocator because we can just use filters on the other side to filter what we actually want to use from the ender chest. And this one over here, this one keeps nether quartz. That one we're going to reuse. I just did a separate one because that's all stuff that needs to go back over into this system over here. So... That's why that's there. So anyways, let's get... what kind of dye do we want to use? I'm thinking maybe magenta. Because I don't think we've used magenta anywhere. So let me grab like 6 magenta dye. This is going to be our basically our interchest line that actually connects into a logistics system, because we don't have one that can craft things right now, and that's what we're going to be doing. So let me get a chassis pipe, Mark IV. So we'll go ahead and order that. And then in addition, let's see, what module? I tend to like doing modules. If you notice, I don't generally do like supplier pipes or something like that. I tend to do modules because it gives you a little bit more control. I like doing that more so. And I think what we want is an active supplier module, which takes just a golden chipset and a passive supplier module. So let me see, what do I need for the module? Passive supplier, done, order that stuff. So there's our passive supplier module, and then I'm going to need just a golden chipset to get our active supplier module. And actually, I do want to take a moment here and explain the difference between provider and supplier and active and passive, because I don't think I've actually explained that to you guys yet. So provider modules, basically you've seen us use those for like the right here, the like the drawer systems and things like that. Those have provider modules. So what provider modules do, I can't remember if I've explained this in detail yet. Provider modules provide their items in the attached inventory to the system. So if I come over here, the reason that I can see these items is because there's a provider module saying, you know, hey, these are the items that I have in my inventory. So all our different provider modules are telling us this is the stuff that's in stock. And provider modules allow you to take those items, they provide those items to anywhere in the system that needs those. Okay, and now the reason we made an active supplier module. First off, the reason we made a supplier modules supply items. So if it's attached to an inventory, whether it be a chest, interchest, furnace, you know, anything like that, it's going to take items from the system and it's going to supply those items to that inventory. So that's the best way to think about it. Supplier requests items, providers provide items, you know. Now the difference between active and passive, this is very, very important if you're doing logistics and if you're not familiar with logistics. The difference between active and passive can only pull items that are within the logistics network, traveling through the pipes. So basically items can be routed there. And the way the routing works is basically anytime an item passes through a logistics pipe, that logistics pipe communicates with the whole network and says, you know, where do you want this item to go? And that's why you have to do logistics pipes anytime you have basically like a crossroad, you know, where there's more than two, you know, different ways that it can go. You have to have one there so it can say, are you going to go left? Are you going to go right? Are you going to go forward when you're traveling through that logistics pipe? Now, if you have, say, a passive supplier module, it's only going to be getting items and supplying them to that chest when they are moving through the logistics system. So it can't actively request things from the storage drawers. So if I had a passive supplier module and I said, you know, keep cobblestone in this chest, even though we have almost 2,000 cobblestone in here, it is only going to get cobblestone whenever cobblestone is moving through the logistics system. So probably the most likely occurrence of that would be if cobblestone gets sent into our ender system and it gets pulled out and it's supposed to go to the drawers. Well, the passive one could then say, you know, hey, I would love to have that cobblestone. And then that cobblestone would travel to that location instead of the storage drawers. Now, an active supplier module can actively request things. So it can say, you know, for example, with our eggplant, that's one, you know, the reason I want that is because I want our logistics network to be able to say, hey, I've got room over here for eggplant. Why don't you send me some eggplant? And then the logistics network will say, okay, let me craft some eggplant real quick and I'll send it to you. So basically that's how that works. I hope that makes sense and everything. And that's why we're going to be using the active supplier module. Now, later on, probably in the next couple episodes, I will be setting up certain things with the active supplier module, because in logistics pipes, this is how you combine a supplier module and a provider module, and that's how you basically keep crafted items on hand. So, you know, with AE2, it's the storage bus connected to the interface that keeps items stocked. With logistics, you just do supplier and provider modules. So very, very easy, and we will get into that in the very, very near future. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to set this ender chest up. Actually, I think I want it out of sight. So what we're going to do is we're going to pop over here, and we're going to use this area down here. I like having these, you know, kind of out of the way. So we're going to put our, let's see, I'm going to want a chassis pipe. So let me go grab that real quick. I think I'd actually already requested it. So we'll get our Mark IV chassis, and we're just going to put this, I think, right here. Oops, not right there. Okay. It's going to go right here. And then I'm going to go ahead and dye that magenta. Magenta, magenta, magenta. Marsha, Marsha, Marsha. And we're going to put our chassis pipe onto there, and then let's go ahead and add the active supplier module. And in here, we can set the items to keep stocked. And so we're going to tell it, you know, keep stuffed eggplant stocked. And I'll tell you what, I want a stack of stuffed eggplant in here at all times. And we're going to leave it, I think, on bulk 50. Look at this system going. Okay, I'm actually going to set this to partial instead. And I'm kind of retroactively recording this because I realized after, you know, whenever I went to go edit the video that I didn't actually go over what all these mean. I don't think I've actually covered these with you guys. So really, really quickly, let's go over what all these settings mean because they're actually pretty important if you're setting up a logistics network. If it's set to partial, okay, partial is going to request items anytime that it's not full. So if it, you know, for example, if this ender chest does not have 64 stuffed eggplant in it, it's going to request some stuffed eggplant. And let's say there was 32 stuffed eggplant in the chest and, you know, it wants 32 more stuffed eggplant. Well, there just went some. It can't, you know, it can't request all 32 of those because say we only have 16 garlic in the system. What it's going to do on partial is it's going to, you know, if we have say 8 let's say we have 8 garlic in the system. It's going to request as much stuffed eggplant, in this case 8 per se, that it can do, and then it's just going to wait until there's more in the system, and then say more garlic or more eggplant come in, it's going to request as much as it can to try to fill that up. So partial's generally pretty good setting to set things on. Full means that it's only going to request when there's enough items in the system to fill its need. So if it needed 32 stuffed eggplant and we only had, say, 16 garlic, it's not going to request any stuffed eggplant until there's 32 garlic in there. So full is going to order the entire bulk amount or nothing at all. Bulk 50 means that it's going to wait until it's 50% of the total, you know, the max or what it actually needs to keep in the chest. So in this case, 64. Bulk 50, it's not going to request any more stuffed eggplant until it gets down to 32, and then it would request 32 eggplant. It's going to request, basically, it's going to wait till 50% and then request everything to fill itself back up. Bulk 100 means that it's going to let itself get emptied. So in this case, you know, it gets 64 stuffed eggplant. It would not order any more stuffed eggplant until it has 0 stuffed eggplant, and then it would order 64. So it orders 100% of the order. And then infinite means that it's just going to keep ordering items until the inventory is full. So, you know, even if I only had 1 stuffed eggplant here, if I set this to infinite, it's just going to keep ordering and keep ordering and keep ordering until this chest is completely filled. So right now the chest is empty. It's trying to fill up the hoppers and stuff. We ran out of garlic and whatnot. But anyways, back to what we were doing. So what we're going to do is let me actually order some conduits here really, really quick. Okay, so there's our item conduits. And what I want to do is we're going to set up our ender chest. Okay, I think we're going to set our ender chest right here. Let's go ahead and color it magenta, magenta, magenta. And then we're basically just going to run our item conduits up. Now, we're going to say you insert into the hopper. There's that. And then we're going to run them to this side now. I'll plug that up. And so now if we just say extract always active, we should see these are starting to fill up with stuffed eggplant. Oh, and let me set it to round robin, actually. It's like prioritizing that one. All right, so now it's sending, and I just heard one of those eat just a second ago. Let me remove that. And I'll have to come through and facade all this, but that's fine. So now, these should be running. You can see they're both getting mana. Awesome. This one's already... These Gormialis actually do produce a lot of mana. So now that that's running, let me go grab... How many Blacker Lotuses do we have at the moment? 14. That's like both mana pools filled or something like that. Blacker Lotuses provide an absolute ton of mana, just for the record. But for example, if I throw this in here... I just realized something major before I do that. I don't even have this set up completely right. I do apologize. I'm derping so much today, I feel like. I have this running through, which is fine. It would activate that, but then it would just let the hopper run constantly. GG me. So what we're going to do instead is this cable. The only change I need to make is this cable just needs to plug up. Okay. This cable just needs to plug up right there. Basically is all that needs to happen. And then we just have to do the same right here. Okay. So basically the timer can turn it off, but if this is getting a signal, then it won't. You know, it'll be something inputting a signal other than just the redstone torch. So, I do apologize. I don't know. I don't know what's got into me today. So now, for example, if we fill this mana pool up... Alright, so now this one is filled. So if we were to break this off, for example... Okay, it's not connecting to the structure pipe right now. There we go. That works. Okay. There we go. So now it's sending a signal. It's saying, you know, hey, this mana pool is filled. This mana pool is completely filled. And, you know, even without that connected... You're not able to send a signal over. So, once again, I apologize. It's been a little while since I've used some of this stuff, this 1.7 stuff. So, when the timer comes around this time, you should see that the redstone signal does not change. It stays solid, and that's because the transport pipe is saying, you know, this mana's full, so you're getting a signal from me as well. So, that's how that works. So, let me just adjust this one really, really quick and fix my... fix my 100th derp of the day. And so now, I'm gonna go ahead and use these Blacker Lotuses to get a bit of mana in this pool. It's not completely filled, but that's fine. There is enough in here to start the system anyway. That's what counts. Wonderful. Wonderful. And this is, I mean, this system will keep up with this. I'll come through and I'll clean some of this stuff up so you don't see, like, you know, that bit of cobblestone there and some odd and ends like that. But for the most part, I'm pretty happy with this setup because once I replace the grass and stuff like that, I mean, you won't be able to see, you know, all that. You'll just see some flowers, you know, the open crates, the mana bars coming through. And for the most part, it's fairly well hidden, I feel like. Plus, honestly, those Gormialises are very powerful. Very, very powerful food. Okay, and I had to adjust this redstone because it was hitting the mana spreader that was up here, and I think this one probably is as well. So basically I'm just having the conduit kind of come up the side here. Okay, now that should be able to work, I should think. All right, wonderful, it is working. There is mana burst coming out and everything. So I think we've pretty well got it all set up now. And this is honestly probably going to be filled fairly quickly. Just a little bit of food. And probably we'll probably be able to speed this up a little bit more and produce more mana here very, very shortly. So anyways, now that that's set up, we are ready to actually activate our Elven Portal. So we'll just right-click the Elven Gateway, and ta-da! It's going to drain a little bit of mana from these. You'll notice these start kicking on. Like, that one's shooting bursts now, and we should see it drop food momentarily. Yep, there it was. Good. Very, very good. I love it. I love it. Actually, it's fairly cheap setup, fairly simple. Especially with the farming station getting eggplants and garlic. And one more quick check here. This, is it not ordering? Or is it out of eggplant now? Okay, it's not ordering right now because there's no eggplant or garlic. I mean, there is eggplant, but there's no garlic in the system. So it can't make any eggplant. But, I mean, it was initially filling up all those hoppers. So probably, you know, within 30 minutes time, that's going to be done. Plus, I mean, these are going to build up with mana fairly quickly and kind of fill out. Then they're going to stop running and there's not going to be any eggplant being consumed. Occasionally, they'll kick on for a second, send a couple bursts, and then stop. So, all right, so now that we've got that set up, let's go ahead and get ourselves some items and do this next Batania quest. I know we spent a little while on that, but that honestly, that setup's going to help so much. It really is. So the Elven Dreams, we're going to need some Dreamwood. We need 64 Dreamwood, 9 Dragonstone, which of course is mana diamonds that gets that. Then we're going to need 32 Pixie Dust and 32 Elementium. Not a problem. Elementium, I don't have a ton of mana steel. Of course, I've got plenty of iron and plenty of mana. I could make some. Or no, I need steel. That's right. I've got plenty of steel too, though. But I do have this. It's 32. But mana steel is 2-to-1 for Elementium. So the rest of them are 1-for-1, but mana steel is not that way. So do we have... Okay, no, we've got plenty. So I'm going to order a half stack of mana steel. And then let's go ahead and get... I'm just going to order a half stack of diamonds, and I'm going to get a half stack of Ender Pearls. Or is it 2-for-1? No, I think it's 1-for-1 on Pixie Dust. Okay, so we'll grab that stuff. And then I'm going to want a stack of Living Wood. Okay, there's that. We're going to have to automate that stuff soon. I'm going to have to fix all this vivid grass too, but it's fine. It's cheap to change it over. So let's get mana diamonds. Or mana pearls. Mana diamonds. Wow. When you start bulk crafting like that, it actually uses up a lot of mana. And yeah, now we're set. So all we need to do now is just chuck this stuff through the portal. And temporarily, I am going to fix that as well with Living Rock. That's weird. You can't actually see the spreaders through the portal. But we'll throw in our Living Wood, start getting our Dream Wood. Now we'll be able to make Elven mana spreaders, which are so much nicer as well. All right, there's our Dream Wood. Then we'll get our Elementium. Wait, what? I just threw a stack of mana steel in there and it... Oh, is this different? Say, Dragonstone is mana diamond. Pixie Dust is mana pearl. Elementium. Whoa! Oh my god, okay. That would be why. I did not expect that to be different. I really didn't. Okay, well, let's get our Pixie Dust and our Dragonstones real quick. And then we'll get started on some Terra Steel. I thought there was an Elementium Seed, isn't there? No. There is Terra Steel Seed, so... We will be able to get this, but we need Temperio Essence to do it. Whew, that's expensive. Okay, so to get our Master Infusion Stone, we just need one block of Elementium. Okay. Alright, let me make some Terra Steel. Let me do that. At least. Oh my gosh, I cannot believe I wasted all that mana steel. Too. It's terrible. I honestly did not expect Elementium to be changed like that. We'll grab like 5. Okay, there's 11. I mean, it's going to take a little while to get all that Terra Steel. Honestly, it's not too bad because I can just grab, like, say, you know, like 50 levels and then just let it go. And it goes, it actually produces mana at a fairly decent rate, but it is going to be a little bit time consuming. I don't know if I want to go for that. We'll see. Then they're going to want us to make the Gaia stuff. Let's see, is this stuff... That's actually a little bit expensive because they're going to need four of these. Beacons are... We're going to have to get Lumium Glass, but that's not too bad. That's probably going what we're going to use. Oh, you don't even use a Nether Star for these. Huh. That is interesting. I honestly expected that, and you get two full hearts. And then they want us to get the Ring of Odin. Okay. That's Gaia Guardian Mark II. Alright. Oh, and I was actually thinking about upgrading our spreaders to Elven Mana spreaders, but that requires Elementium as well. So, honestly, I think the first batch of Elementium, I'm just going to go for the Master Infusion Stone. I mean, it's a little bit more than just Elementium, of course, but... I think we're going to go for that. So one thing I am going to do just really, really quickly is I'm going to put a chest. Let's say we're going to put the chest right here for right now. This is going to be like a temporary chest that we're going to work with. And we're going to start just throwing some things together for the Master Infusion Stone. I'm probably not going to do all this on camera. But like we just need like a Mana Pearl, for example. I mean, a lot of this stuff we can go ahead and just kind of prep it. Compressed Gaia, we still need to work on. Zavisio blocks, not terribly expensive. Let me grab, I'm just going to grab them out of here. So what we only needed like one, oh, but it's nine blocks that we're going to need. That's fine. Let me get a little bit more of Zavisio here. So there we go. Honestly, I need to actually compress this stuff. There's mass Zavisio. Oh, wow. That would go perfect in a compacting drawer. I may upgrade at least the... Yeah, I'll probably end up upgrading these maybe to compacting drawers. Wouldn't mind having those as compacting. There's our Ender Pearl. We've got our Mass Zavisio block. Let me see. We're also going to need block of Dragonstone, block of Mana Diamond. That stuff's not... And honestly, that's nothing. And then diamond, we're just going to need nine of these. I mean, some of this stuff is very, very cheap, and some of it's very expensive. Elementium is going to be a pain. Block of Terra Steel, block of Mana Steel, and a Nether Star. Okay. I do have a Nether Star around here somewhere, so. And we'll get our block of Mana Steel. Okay. All right. And I think that'll, you know, that's going to be the use of our first Nether Star, for sure. So there's block of Mana Steel, block of Dragonstone, Mass Zavisio block. And then we can just really quickly convert this stuff over. There we go, block of Mana Diamond. So right now the only thing that we're missing, oh, and I've got a Nether Star right over here as well. So, yeah, right there. So I figure what I'll do is I'll continue making a bit of Terra Steel. We'll get the quest knocked out. You know, this quest right here, they want us to get 32 Elementium. It's kind of a lot. And once we have that 32, then we can use, you know, 9 of it for a block. I'll try to get the Terra Steel block. Honestly, by next episode, I should be able to get everything on this list prepped except for the compressed Gaia. So that's going to be the most expensive part, I do believe. Yeah. So, anyways, I'll work on that stuff and all that good stuff. I'm kind of torn. Part of me says, you know, go ahead, make that, yeah, let's do it. You know what? Honestly, it would make things a lot faster for me. So we're going to go ahead and get ourselves just four Elven Mana Spreaders. I know it's about wrapping up point. Oh yeah, I'm going to need four pieces of Elementium. Another thing I will say is that we will probably change over this Gormialis system very, very soon, because one thing that we can do that's fairly cheap to make is beef Wellington. This restores, if you notice, it restores a ton of hunger. That's going to be our next food that we move into. But I have to get, I've got beef already being produced. Dough is not really an issue, just requiring flour from wheat. And then salt and water and stuff. But we're going to need spinach and mushrooms being produced. I can also do white mushrooms or whatever. But honestly, I mean, possibly even by next episode, because really if I get spinach, because I don't think I have spinach. No. Okay. I'll try to get some spinach, though, started. And if we get that, we may move on over to beef Wellingtons. Be, you know, eating like the best food we can we can manage. There is a little bit better food that we'll get into down the road, but beef Wellington's pretty top tier, honestly. But what I'm thinking is we'll just remove all of these spreaders. But basically, these mana spreaders aren't keeping up with how fast these Rose Arcanas are getting mana, honestly. So what we're going to do is we're going to set up our mana spreaders like right here. We're going to bind these to the mana distributor. And there we go. Easy as that. And these are still bound to where those old mana spreaders were located. So they're sending their mana there. And now we can, you know, we can pull out, say, the 10 levels or the 50 levels. 50 levels goes a really long way with the Rosa Arcana. But honestly, 50 levels is not much in this system. So, you know, there is that. I really don't need this whole thing. I need to just remove this. But yeah, so I'll work on that Terra Steel and stuff, and we'll see. Next episode, we are either... Of course, next episode is coming out tomorrow. So we are either going to be working on... Probably working towards the Gaia Guardian. And we may plug up Spawn, work on that. But to do the Gaia Guardian, we're going to need some upgraded armor. Because what we're wearing right now is not... You know, it's not going to cut it, even if I was wearing full artifact or whatever. It's really not going to cut it. So I think what we're going to do, since we are pretty well sorted in magical crops, I think we're going to go for Zavisio armor. But if you recall, we looked at this stuff before, because we can do like protections and stuff like that. The only thing is this stuff, I mean, there's a whole lot of steps involved. I mean, we have to go do all kinds of stuff in the Erebus and just all over the place. The nice thing, though, is if we get this Avisio stuff, it does have flight built in, has 96% damage reduction, and negates fall damage. So it's definitely something I would like to get into. Honestly, if I would just get Avisio and stay with Avisio, I think, instead of going to anything else. And it's also, it's really not out of our way, because I know that the Avisio stuff is used to make dark plate, and dark plate is used to make that dark solarium jet plate. So, you know, it's definitely something that we'll probably end up going for, because dark solarium, that jetpack is super fast. Super, super fast for travel. I don't know. I don't know if we'll go for that or if we'll just stick with Zavisio, though. That's the only thing, because Zavisio's endless flight, the only thing is it does have durability, but if I recall, it can be repaired pretty easily with Zavisio ingots. So I don't know. Plus, you get a lot of really nice buffs from the Zavisio stuff if you infuse it. So I don't know. But anyways, I think that's what we're going to be doing next episode. We may, like I said, we may try to plug up Spawn just really, really quickly, because I don't think that's really going to take all that long. Because I'll cut, you know, as I'm running the actual tubes all the way over here. I'm not going to make you guys sit through all of that, but. We may plug that up and then work on armor upgrades. So, because we're not going to be able to face the Gaia Guardian until we get some better armor. But honestly, I think Zavisio, we get that and we're pretty well set on the Gaia Guardian. I think we'll pretty much be game, set, match at that point. So, anyways, I am going to end this episode here. Like I said, there'll be another episode tomorrow. So I hope you guys are looking forward to it. And also, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. So as always, if you did, be sure and hit that like button, and go ahead and subscribe if you're not already for more daily videos. And once again, I hope you guys have a wonderful Easter, and I hope to see you guys on Sunday with the next episode. So until then, as always, do take care, stay safe, and I will see you guys then.